For the past 3 years, I've generated over 100,000 AI images using over 100 AI image tools. And if I could go back and talk to myself 3 years ago and give myself lessons on how I can effectively learn and use AI image generation, here's what I would say. Lesson 1. AI generates images from noise. This randomness is a feature, not a bug. That's why you'll find that the same prompt can give completely different results. So lesson 1 is understanding that AI is a slot machine. If you know that your prompt is solid, just keep rerunning it, and eventually you'll get the results that you want. Lesson 2 is something I discovered when I was checking AI Advantages prompt testing document for new AI models. I noticed that they were using single emoji prompts like a rainbow or a dragon. So lesson 2 is to try one word prompts or emojis. Lesson 3. Anyone can generate AI images now. The technical barrier is gone. What matters is knowing what looks good for the specific context that you need. So lesson 3 is that taste is your superpower. Taste means understanding what aesthetic works for your purpose. For example, you're creating medieval content. More often than not, medieval content will look better on Renaissance painting styles instead of 3D hyperrealism. So taste is about choosing the right style for your situation. And this is developed through exposure and practice. Technical skill is commoditized now, so always remember that taste is your edge. Lesson 4. When models first emerged, the challenge was always, how do I prompt this? And I very quickly found that in order to get the results that I wanted, I had to follow like specific prompt formats, add specific modifiers. It was difficult. But eventually the models got good and they became better at understanding natural language. Now you can basically create almost any image just from describing it like how you would describe it to a friend. These days, the question really isn't how do I prompt this, but rather what do I create? So lesson number 4 is that ideas are your real constraint. With how good and easy it is to prompt the models now, having real interesting ideas is the value point and not the skill to prompt these models. Lesson 5. Early on, I wanted to save money on subscriptions. So I committed to just one tool, Midjourney, and I used it for everything. And since I was paying for it, I wanted to believe that it was the best for everything. And for the longest time, it kind of was. But the thing is, eventually, other models started popping up and other models started getting good, but I was closed-minded and I just used Midjourney for everything. But then I realized I couldn't really take advantage of everything that AI image generation has to offer, since it was becoming more obvious that each tool has its strengths for different tasks. So lesson 5 is to stop looking for the perfect tool. Now, I have a daily driver, which is still Midjourney, by the way, but depending on what I need, I now go to different tools. Like, for example, if I need to edit images, Nano Banana is better than Midjourney for that, so I use that. So it's about realizing that there's a right tool for the job. You can't use a hammer to fix everything in your house. The same goes for AI image generation. Lesson 6. When learning how to fight, I had to throw 1,000 jabs a day with perfect form. When I first became a product manager, I had to write hundreds of specification tickets to learn how to communicate instructions better to engineers. The pattern is consistent. You can see that skill development requires high volume. And the same principle applies to AI image generation. You'll eventually get good through sheer repetition. Lesson number 6 is that volume is everything. Each generation, even the bad ones, teaches you something. Eventually, you will have a better sense of what works and what doesn't. So there really is no shortcut to putting in the reps. Lesson number 7. The first few weeks of AI image generation is exciting. Everything is new. And then eventually, you hit the wall. You run out of use cases and reasons to even generate images. And the thing is, random generation doesn't build your skills systematically. So when I encountered this challenge, I knew that I needed a structured reason to maintain the volume and the learning. That's why I decided to create a faceless YouTube channel about a topic that I really like, which is mythology and historical stories. So the videos were mostly made up of AI images I generated, and I stuck them together in like a story format. And the thing is, the videos required at least 20 or 30 AI images. I suddenly had a consistent demand for the AI images I generated. So lesson 7 is to start a long-term project. This long-term project of the Faceless YouTube channel allowed me to put massive volume with the purpose and context that I needed to stay consistent. Lesson 8. Even very early on, I was a frequent visitor of discover pages that you see with this AI image generation tools, and I often saw great results. And when I look at the prompt, these long elaborate prompts with like these descriptions that I never would have thought of, using specific keywords like camera angles, lighting effects, and so on. And I thought to myself, like, I'm sure they're not writing this from scratch. So I had an idea. I said, what if AI can help me write prompts for me? So I basically found this Midjourney prompting guide from Google, and I told ChatGPT to help me create image prompts based on this guide. So I described the image, it gave me a prompt, I fed it to Midjourney, and the results were really good. Lesson 8 is to use AI to write your prompts. This is how I write most of my prompts now. I have actually a dedicated Claude project that is trained on how to write text-to-image prompts for the different AI models, and then I just simply go to that project, I describe the image I like, and then I get an optimized prompt back. Lesson 9. Sometimes I come across these great looking images and I want to recreate them, but I really don't know how to describe them. The good news is AI models now have really great vision capabilities and they can analyze almost any image. So lesson 9 is to reverse engineer images using AI. So you just take an image that you like and upload it to ChatGPT or Claude, and then ask them to describe it. And then you can just deconstruct this and create a prompt from it. Lesson 10. You have to know that AI models are trained on millions of professionally shot images. So lesson 10 is to use photography terminology. So talk to it like you're talking to a professional photographer, because it will understand different technical terms like wide angle shot, shallow depth of field, rule of thirds, golden hour lighting, and so on. This will allow you to get better results with less trial and error. Lesson 11. Sometimes you just use a prompt and it gives you stellar results. So lesson 11 is to simply keep a prompt database of all these prompts that gave you good results. You'll be thanking yourself in the future if ever you want to recreate a stellar result you had before and you have just these list of prompts that are killer. Lesson 12. AI generates good images out of the box, but sometimes they're missing that final 2% to really make it stand out and usable for what you need. So lesson 12 is to learn basic editing. Even simple tools like Canva work, which is what I personally use. This will allow you to take your images from 98% to 100%. Lesson 13. Almost everything I know from AI image generation has come from experimentation or learning from YouTube. So lesson 13 is to learn from the community. Subscribe to AI image generation YouTubers to really see what's actually working and to get the best advice on how you can leverage these AI tools effectively. This is really the best way to stay current without the constant need for researching for yourself. Lesson 14. If you're a highly critical person, you would often fear your output being judged. But AI doesn't judge you. It just follows instructions. Only you are the ones who see your failed generations that didn't really fit your standards. And the great thing is, if you don't like the results of your prompt, then just rerun it, like we said, right? AI is a slot machine. So lesson 14 is to not fear bad output. No one is watching your process. No one's criticizing your attempts. And you now have more freedom than you've ever had before with just generating images from text. Don't let your fear stop you from just putting in that volume and learning. Lesson 15. AI is improving at an unbelievable rate. I've been in tech for more than a decade, and I have never seen a technology improve as quickly as AI does. So lesson 15 is that the models will keep improving. Just know that what's challenging currently will be easy in 6 months, most likely. I mean, that's what I hope, at least. What's important is that you focus on developing taste and coming up with good ideas rather than fighting or looking for workarounds for what the current tech can do. Eventually, it can do what you want. Lesson 16 is to always be upskilling. Test new models and tools as they emerge. Experiment with the new capabilities that they bring. And never stop trying new techniques and approaches. Growth comes from continually trying to push your own personal boundaries and also the boundaries of these AI models. And like I mentioned in the previous lesson, this field is evolving at a very rapid rate. So basically, it's changing too fast for you to ever be done with learning. Lesson 17. Generating images for yourself is fun and comfortable, but it's very low stakes. There's no real pressure if your results aren't perfect. I remember this one time I got a project from Upwork. The client was a doctor from Nigeria, and he wanted an AI image generated that he will eventually turn into a painting and put into the doctor community center back in his village in Nigeria. So knowing that there was another person relying on the quality of this image I generated, and knowing also that there was a deep meaning behind this image, allowed me to push myself further and harder than I've ever had before on my AI image generation journey. So lesson 17 is to take on real client work. This will give you real accountability, whether it's a paid client or just a project for a friend. I upskilled faster with this project in weeks compared to months of just generating images for myself. Lesson 18. We all have art styles that resonate more with us compared to others. And the great thing is that these art style keywords and references work great across almost any AI image generation model. So lesson 18 is to use art styles. Resources like midlibrary.io have a massive collection of these art styles. This saves you significant time, especially if you need a consistent aesthetic for a project. Lesson 19. Image models aren't as good as they are now. Before, you can't generate consistent characters from one reference image. The solution was to train Alora. So since the process was quite technical, I initially got turned off. But eventually, since I really wanted to create consistent characters, I dived deep and watched tutorials on how to do it properly. And the effort was worth it. Not only was I able to train the Alora and to generate consistent characters, but I also taught myself to not be afraid of these technical tasks, because again, a lot of people will guide you through this step by step through the YouTube videos that they create. So lesson 19 is to move out of your comfort zone and not be afraid of taking these more technical workflows. Because once you do one, you prove to yourself that you can handle the more advanced aspects of AI image generation, and it helps you break through this too complicated mental barrier that you most likely have. Lesson 20. Image generation tools are great, but more often than not, the control they provide you is lacking. It's usually just a prompt, you define some parameters, and then you get the final image. But there's really no way for you to refine the process step by step. So lesson number 20 is to learn ComfyUI. ComfyUI gives you the most control over the entire generation process. It's a node-based interface that allows extreme customization for every parameter, really giving you precise control on the final output of your image generations. And again, it looks very complicated and intimidating from the start, but once you start learning it, then you will unlock a whole new skill set for yourself. It's not necessary for most standard use cases, but if you really want to dive deep into AI image generation, then ComfyUI is the best tool for you to learn. Lesson 21. Most AI tools have built-in image upscaling capabilities. But if you're looking for billboard quality upscales, then these just won't cut it. So lesson 21 is to use dedicated image upscalers. Many free tools available online work really well. And there are also paid tools like Topaz Labs or Magnific that give you more premium professional results. So these dedicated image upscalers don't just enhance, but actually add a bit more fine detail to your images. It's very quick and easy to do, and it provides massive improvement to the final quality of your images. Lesson 22. Sometimes we generate images that are almost there. It's at 98%, but it's lacking that 2% of final polish. And regenerating these images from the same prompt often doesn't work because the images get changed too much. AI image editing is now a powerful new capability that's just becoming accessible with models like Nano Banana that specialize in precise image editing capabilities. So lesson 22 is to master AI image editing. This is way more powerful and faster than the manual editing methods. It will allow you to change just the clothes, the background, or fix any small details that you want while keeping the rest of the image intact. The capability is still developing, but it's already incredibly useful as it is. And finally, lesson 23 is that subscriptions add up, and it can get expensive real quick. But what if you're like me and you want to try out every new AI image or video model that comes up? Well, the good news is many AI tools offer API access with per request pricing models. So lesson 23 is to use API pricing to control your cost. So sign up for platforms like Replicate or Fal AI and put a couple of dollars in credits in there. This will allow you to test different AI image or video models, and you only pay for what you actually generate. So it's gonna be per image or per video. This is great for testing new models before actually committing to a subscription. And it gives you flexibility to access all of these tools affordably. And speaking of subscriptions, a free one you can make is subscribing to this channel for more helpful content like this. If you want to learn more about AI image generation, editing, and just AI use in general, then make sure to check out this video.